Kathleen to introduce. It's Kathleen T. Whitehead, but she's KT to everybody. And obviously she's talking on the uncomfortable marriage of law and medicine, which is a tremendously large topic of interest to all of us. And she's a certified elder attorney here in San Antonio, and her practice emphasizes elder law issues, including things like Medicaid planning, estate planning, guardianships, and probate. And she works with seniors, caregivers, and families to plan for their future legal and personal needs. And I think all of us need to think of those kinds of things for ourselves, not just our patients. And she also expands traditional estate planning to include planning for life issues surrounding aging, which should be of interest as well. She's a graduate, her law doctor, from Lewis and Clark College in Northwestern School of Law in Portland, Oregon, and has been an elder law attorney since 1994 and is on the board of directors of the National Academy. In addition, she's had a number of interesting positions on the way to becoming an elder lawyer, and I think one of the things that's interesting is that she has her now lapsed, inactive at least, nursing home administrator's license. So she really is quite educated and can speak intelligently about a lot of these topics, and she speaks all over the country and has been someone who talks about decision-making standards in guardianships, how to avoid a guardianship, probate versus trusts, estate planning basics, Medicaid planning, as I mentioned, and planning for long-term care. So we're looking forward to your talk.
Thanks. Thank you. My hope is, since you're small enough, that we can have kind of an informal discussion. So as I go along, if you have questions, just interrupt or let me know, raise your hand. And I know a lot of you have kind of heard parts of this talk before, so if I get boring, change the subject by asking a good question. I think the title of this sort of says it all, The Uncomfortable Marriage Between Medicine and Law. And the intersection we're going to talk about today is the psychiatric and the guardianship issue and how those two are going to dovetail. And so I've passed out the affidavit that we use in guardianships, and it's the medical affidavit. And those of you who heard me say that what happens on this affidavit most times is that we'll get it back and it will say, what's the general nature of capacity? Dementia. What is Mrs. Smith's medical history related to incapacity? She has dementia. What is the prognosis? It'll get worse. And then we kind of go through here and we're like, okay, but what we're really asking from a legal standpoint is, can she handle her own affairs? And we want to know really nitty gritty, can she write a check? If she writes a check, can she balance the checkbook? Can she come into your office as physicians? And will she be able to, let me get this stuff off the table. Will she be able to make a good medical decision? And one of the things that always amuses me is that the psychiatrists always say she can make medical decisions. And I think the issue is, can she make a medical decision on a day-to-day basis? Can she set up the appointment at your office? Can she keep that appointment? Can she fill the prescription that you hand her? Can she take that medication on a day-to-day basis? Or is she making a general kind of underlying medical decision about a major medical issue? And I think the distinction that an expert witness psychiatrist once said was, if it's a general decision, like am I going to have chemotherapy for cancer, she probably has some long-term memory and long-term held value system that's going to play into that decision. But when it comes to our legal question of can she handle medical decisions, what we're asking you to tell us is, can she go home and take that blood pressure medicine every day and keep her health good? And if the answer is no, then you have to look back behind this and figure out what's going on. And what I find really fascinating is most people will go through this questionnaire and they'll be telling us she's just fine, and they get to the section on page 2 that starts with number 9, and it's, does this person, if they don't have full capacity, can they do the following? And this is where we're really asking you to get into the nitty-gritty. Can they handle certain things? For example, could they file a lawsuit on a debt, collect rentals, wages, and other claims? In other words, if they have a rental property, can they go and resolve an issue with a tenant? Can they handle getting the rent? Do they know when the tenant's behind or just conning them? Are they able to make those kinds of judgments? On the debt issue, what we're asking are simple things. If they have a problem on their credit card statement, are they going to be able to handle resolving it? Can they get behind that credit card and go in there and figure out how to resolve the credit card? The other one that we're looking at then is, can they pay, compromise, and defend claims? And what we're looking at there is, if the neighbor gets mad because the tree fell on their house, are they going to be able to go out and work with the neighbor to file the insurance claim, take care of it, and get that all down? We're, you know, these are kind of esoteric things, but we're asking for that practical kind of day-to-day stuff. Did you have a question?
No.
Okay. And then the other, that's right. The other is, do they have the authority to contract, and or the power? Are they able to? And contracts are the simple things like checks, going to Sears and buying a washing machine, going to the car dealership and buying a car. And a lot of times the value judgment that we make in court is always going to be based on your medical decision, but what we're going to do is put it in context of what can that person afford to lose. So when I have somebody who has a $20 million estate, it's okay if they carry $1,000 cash. If I have someone who has a $20,000 estate, I'm probably going to give them, you know, 15, 20 bucks. And that's what we're looking at, is what's that range? And so then what we want to hear from you is not what they can afford to lose, but what can they handle? If I give them this money, how are they going to be able to handle it? You know, can they go out and evaluate how to buy a washing machine? Can they even make a simple decision like buying a dress in a store? Does it fit? Doesn't it fit? Can they go in the dressing room and not get muddled up and come out with a decision? Or is that whole three choices going to be too much for them? And if it is, then we don't want to give them much power to contract, because they aren't able to handle that sort of simple decision. I think when we were at the medical seminar a few months ago, the physician that spoke talked about ordering off a menu. And that was such a great question, was can they go in and order off a menu? Because when you think about that, organizing those choices, it's really hard. And if they aren't able to organize those simple choices, then they probably aren't going to be able to organize their checkbook or their bank statement or anything more complicated. So when we're asking about that power to contract and you're looking at these affidavits, if you can kind of think about those sorts of really day-to-day practical issues when you're filling it out. Can they receive funds from government sources? And since I'm sitting at the VA hospital, you know, one of them, of course, is the VA. Another is Social Security. And what we're asking is, are they able to go in and apply for those benefits, follow through on that application, and when it's denied, are they going to be able to appeal it? And frankly, the VA and Social Security are very difficult benefits to apply for. And if someone doesn't have capacity, they're not going to be able to do those simple day-to-day tasks. And that's what we're trying to get at in that question. One of the other issues that we're looking at is to enroll in public and private residential care facilities. And what we're talking about there are obviously group homes, nursing homes, applying for Medicaid, doing all of those sort of really fundamental things that people have to do as they age. We're looking at whether or not they have the power and authority to make employment decisions. You know, can they go down and volunteer at Walmart or apply for a job at Walmart and be a greeter and know when they need to go on a break, that they need to sit down, or that they can't work 60 hours a week because somebody didn't show up, or they shouldn't pull a double shift? Are they able to understand that sort of thing, that someone who may be younger is going to say, I'm not working because I'm tired, but someone older who has a really strong work ethic isn't going to be able to say that, and they're not going to say it because they don't understand their health, being understand what they can and can't do. Can you see? And psych world always say that. I think about the consultant on that, if love treatment with the patients, back to the front we talked about, authority to consent to the, this can check time. But we're probably asking about this because the older person, if they're sort of moderately demented, is still in that cagey phase where they don't want to be under a guardianship. They may be rejecting care. And one of the things they're doing is refusing to give their family information. So the family's coming to you saying, what's going on with mom and dad? And you're saying, I can't say because of privacy. And they're saying no. And so when we're looking at capacity, one of the things we look at is, can they consent and do they understand that consent? Looks like I better stand up.
So can you get away without it?
The other one, of course, is the medical and dental treatment and testing. Dental treatment is very tricky with the older adult, and a lot of times they haven't had regular, and yet we know that's one of the fundamental factors to good health in aging. And so how do we get them in there, and if they're consenting or not consenting? And what are good choices for an older adult as opposed to a younger adult, and are they able to ascertain that sort of choice? So when that's what we're looking for in there. The power and authority to consent and enroll in educational services usually doesn't apply to older adults, but this affidavit is also used for MHMR folks. And then military service, again, that's usually a question that we have that comes up with folks with mental illness or someone who may be a very high-functioning but has some impairment with mental retardation or mental ability. Then we have the power to enter into and procure insurance contracts. This is going to become more and more important because one of the biggest cons we see are annuity salesmen. And annuity salesmen are those that are out there that have the lowest licensing for financial products. It has the highest commission, and it's the most attractive product. And what we see is our seniors locking their assets up into these contracts. Typically, there's a penalty if they come back and try to cash them out. It can be between 10 and 30% of the contract. They may not be able to cash and get anything out for 10 years. So when you get to this question, take time and really ponder it, because if you check, yes, they do, we can't go back around those contracts and go back to the insurance company or go to the insurance commission and try to get that money out. And then we have the problem of how do we pay for care. So this is, again, annuities are a fairly complicated contract, and for an older adult to understand them, it's going to be difficult, and the consequences are quite grave. And we have one of the biggest frauds we had going on several years ago is these insurance salesmen would go out, they'd sell them contract A, then they'd go out and sell them contract B, and they'd be rolling them over, and the penalties would get worse and worse as they rolled them over, because the next company would pay the penalties on the first contract to get the second contract, they'd pay a bigger commission, and so it would get real exacerbated. The final one on here is the ability to consent for MHMR centers and other placements. I think the goal of this affidavit, when you get these, is that someone is concerned that we need to have help for an older individual. And you as physicians and medical personnel are the gatekeepers in the court system, because we can't move forward in the court system without some type of medical evidence or medical affidavit. And so this is going to be the first thing that you're going to see in the guardianship proceeding. And one of the information there is going to be the threshold and the guidance. We may get it and say, we want to have more information, so we'll send out for neuropsychological testing or more in-depth psychiatric testing. But this is going to be sort of at least the threshold. 90% of the cases won't go beyond this affidavit because it will be clear and it's going to be a fundamental, there's nothing here to argue about. But when we get into contested cases and contested guardianship, this affidavit becomes a very crucial piece of the starting point of where we go. So when we're looking at this, and you get this, it means that there's been a question. You may be the initiating party. You may be seeing an older adult in your office and you may be concerned. And I want to make sure that I cover this, so I'm going to sort of diverge here and take a little tangent. But if you have someone that you are concerned about with capacity and you do not believe that they are able to handle things, or you believe they're being taken advantage of by their representative payee or their family, it's extremely important that you report to Adult Protective Services. And you can go on to the Adult Protective Services website, log in, and the code word is professional, and you can go right in and make the report. In that report, you need to be specific about what's wrong. You need to be clear about whether or not it's a physical emergency, a financial emergency. Your report is going to be given a great deal of deference, and if you say there's a physical emergency, they're likely to visit within 24 hours. So it's very important that you use that power, because it can really cut off abuse and fraud down the road. The other issue with reporting that it's important that you recognize is that there is no privilege. There is absolutely no privilege for reporting abuse. No one has a privilege. I don't have a privilege. You don't have a privilege. No professional has a privilege. If you suspect there's abuse, you must report. That's the law. So if you have any telltale signs on a child, on an adult, on anyone, you must report that abuse. So don't overlook the power of it, and of course use it wisely, but it is important to use that and make sure that we do get accurate reporting so that we can cut that off early instead of down the road. The other issue on abuse, typically it's said that doctors, don't shoot me for this, are the first people conned, because who you're seeing in your office is the patient and the caregiver. And we've got to make sure that the caregiver is really someone who should be in charge of the care and is doing a good job. And if it's the new best friend or the neighbor, it's probably important to do a little bit of probing on your part to make sure that that neighbor is an appropriate person, that she has been involved with this person's life. It's not somebody who's new to the neighborhood. It's not the nice Christian young man who just moved in. You know, these are all the things that we hear the older adults say. And it's okay to be a little bit cynical, and it's important to talk to the older adult alone without the caregiver in the office. And I know it's really easy when we get busy to sort of say, oh, it's easier to get the information here than from the older adult. But it's really crucial that we do that, particularly with those of you in geriatrics. And I know it's very painful in family practices. I watch how busy those clinics are, and you're lucky to have 10 minutes for a patient. I think the other thing, going back to my prepared remarks on this medical affidavit, when we're talking about guardianships, what you can see is we're not talking about a black and white line. This is a line that varies from day to day, from moment to moment. And what we're trying to figure out is on a spectrum of can handle everything to handle nothing. Where is this person? What can they handle or can't they handle? And so when we're going into court, this medical affidavit becomes the roadmap of the court order for a guardianship. And our law says that we must seek the least restrictive alternative. So one of the first things we're looking at is this a fleeting thing? Is there something treatable? Is this an organic condition that can be treated and then they're going to come back? Is this a condition that is mental illness, and if we treat the underlying mental illness, that we're still going to have dementia, or if we treat the underlying dementia, the underlying mental illness, we're going to bring them to a functioning level. And there's been a lot of publicity lately of schizophrenics who are functioning and carrying on normal jobs and all this kind of thing. And so we want to make sure when we're doing a guardianship that we don't have someone who, if they're medicated properly, can function. I've even had one of the judges write a court order that we get to test the person monthly, and if they're off their meds, they go under a guardianship, and if they're on their meds, then they get to go off and make decisions. And it was one of those that we weren't quite sure how we were going to enforce it, but it actually had the effect we wanted on the person. It gave a lot of motivation to get out there and make sure they took their meds. But so what we want to make sure is that we're doing the right step. The commitment process is entirely separate from the guardianship process. That process is operated out of the DA's office. It's done by filing an affidavit. You as physicians can be the initiator, or the family can be the initiator. If the family's the initiator, there's a very simple affidavit that they can fill out. If you're trying to get somebody in for treatment and you need to have them picked up, they can apply at the courthouse. It's in the Justice Center downtown. I know a lot of you are here for short term, but those of you who are here long term, it's in the new courthouse in the basement,
and it's in the same room as the child support, so you can give real explicit directions and get people in there. And it's, they go in and they fill out a very simple affidavit where they outline how this person is a danger to themselves, how they're a danger to others, and whether or not they're getting worse, a deteriorating condition. And if they meet those criteria, the DA issues a warrant and they pick the person up and they bring them in for evaluation. If you all are trying to get them here to the VA, and do you still have the inpatient geriatric or the inpatient treatment here for psychiatric?
Yes.
Yes? Psych, okay, not inpatient. Okay, then you don't want them coming here. You can actually designate a facility, or the family can, if you know, for example, you've got a bed at Laurel Ridge and the family's checked and the insurance will cover it, you can make that note on that affidavit. So let your family members know, because that's how they're going to get that inpatient treatment at a preferred facility, or one the family prefers or doesn't prefer. The process is that the sheriff goes out, picks up the person, and brings them in for evaluation. And then again, you all become the threshold for that evaluation. And that's the psychiatric exam. And that's a danger to self or others. It's a very different threshold than the guardianship threshold. What we're looking for on this is this person capable of taking care of themselves and making reasonable care and financial decisions? We're not asking, are they a danger to themselves or others? And that's, and so that standard is a shifting standard. So the mental health standard is over here, which is danger to self and others. The guardianship standard is a completely different standard, and it's whether or not they're capable of making reasonable care and financial decisions. You'll have to determine in your evaluation whether or not they need a mental health commitment and then a guardianship, and those two processes can take place together on parallel lines. What we start looking at,
yes, ma'am. Is the, with the involuntary commitment, is that a faster process than the guardianship?
Yes.
Okay.
So if you have an immediate danger, the guardianship is for long-term management, it's for long-term care, you know, it's making sure that you stabilize the housing, the finances. The commitment is to take care of the mental health crisis.
Yeah, how fast can you, what's your turnaround?
On mental health, the pickups are done at 10 and 2. I know this because we had to do one on Christmas Eve. And the 10 o'clock, you have to have your affidavit in by 9. So if you're working with a family member, make sure they know to show up at the DA's office at 8 a.m. to be there when they open. And to be there, you know, otherwise they won't get picked up till they, the warrants get issued at 2, and they're likely to get picked up at 4. And then you're likely to not have, you know, if something goes awry, you don't have a fallback. So you want to get that 9 a.m. warrant issued, so that you've got all day to get the person in and call the physician and get the family and everybody involved that needs to be there.
Mm-hmm.
Any
helpful.
Other questions?
Thank you.
Yeah. The commitment process, though, is that immediate care need. When we're looking at the guardianship and we're looking at that kind of flexible standard, the legal standard varies depending on what we're trying to have them do. So for example, if we're looking at having them do a will, it's one standard. If it were looking at them doing a trust, it's another standard. And so what we're, the legal standard is what the judge is going to impose on your information. So you get these questions from the judge, and for example, on a will, the testator has to know what they have, their bounty. They have to know who the natural object is, which is considered their family members, know who they want to leave it to, and then they have to be able to hold it all together in one thought. So it's not just having those three elements, but having that one thought. So when you get that questionnaire from the judge asking that question, what they're trying to do is, somebody can be under a guardianship, but they can still execute a will. It, because they may have capacity on one level, and they may have a general feel of like, yeah, my estate's worth this amount, I know who my kids are, but I want to leave it to so-and-so because my kids have done, and they'll list all these 20 reasons that are legitimate and valid, and the judge will say, well, I need to have an exam. Can they or can't they do that? On the other hand, if we're looking at a trust, we're looking at a different standard, and the standard itself is a floating standard. It's do they know the business that they're about to undertake, and are they making a decision that a reasonable person would make under similar circumstances? So what we're asking is someone with a $50,000 estate, if they're looking at investing in an annuity as opposed to a CD, do they understand the consequences that if they do the annuity, it's locked up for 10 years, as opposed to the CD that they can put it 6 months or 90 days or whatever and have available for care? So what we're looking at is, do they understand that? And it's probably a lower threshold than the $3 million estate where the person is writing checks to judicial candidates for $1 million or buying cars. And what we're looking at is, are they able to make a decision in a contractual sense that someone under similar circumstances would make? And so that's where your job becomes trickier, because what we're trying to figure out is, can they do this on a consistent basis? A lot of people say, well, they had a flash of insight. And the question is, does that flash of insight allow them to do that transaction? Or is that flash of insight so fleeting that the transaction itself should be set aside because the overall context is so bad? It's really not a black and white issue, and I think that that's one of the most difficult things that we get into in all of this, is it's a shifting sands, and what we're trying to do is to make sure we put adequate protections in place without negating people's civil rights, because that's really what a guardianship does. One of the first things that you'll have to deal with is the privacy issue, and under HIPAA, you as physicians have the ability to make disclosures based on the best interest of the patient. So it's not just whether or not the patient is, whether they've given you permission, but there may be circumstances that allow you to disclose information because of best interest. And I suggest that you get with your hospital attorney. Do you have one? I'm sure. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And find out what what circumstances fit in best interest in your facility, and it's going to shift from facility to facility and probably circumstance to circumstance, but there are a lot of times when you should be disclosing information based on best interest to make sure that your patient is cared for. I guess what I'd like to do is maybe go through a couple of case studies. Would that be helpful to put this into context? Okay. One of them is Mrs. Jones, and she had been married for 60 years. She lived with her husband, and they had 24-hour caregivers around the clock. She'd fallen, broken her hip. She had orders from her rehab facility doctor not to drive. The caregivers were stating that she had been violent and verbally abusive to her family, and that she had physically been quite abusive to her husband. And they said, she's not really strong enough to hurt him, but, a wrong angle, it could hurt him, and she's certainly being quite physical with him. She also was doing the thing that we see frequently, which is firing the caregivers every time they showed up, and then the husband would be left helpless because he was wheelchair bound. She had a long history of alcohol abuse and was drinking on and off, but not with the regularity she had earlier. There were powers of attorney in place and medical directives, but there was no underlying trust or other legal mechanism for ongoing management. And so the question was, what do we do in a situation like this when we're trying to make sure that two people have care in one place, and who do we need to try to get the guardianship on, or what sorts of care issues need to be addressed? In the first issue, she had medical directives. She and her husband both did. But she wasn't allowing the medical help into the house, and medical directives can be revoked, and there is no capacity needed to revoke a medical directive. So she was threatening to revoke them, and the issue was really, had she already revoked them, because there is no legal standard. The other was her financial power of attorney. She was quite angry with her daughter, who'd been managing the money, and didn't like her paying for the caregivers and didn't want her paying for the caregivers. Again, it was a 60-year marriage, and clearly a choice had been made by the husband early on that he was going to stay with the wife, but now he was in a diminished physical and mental state. the first issue to look at in a case like this is there a commitment needed? Is this abuse a new abuse? Is this verbal and physical against the husband? Is this something that's situational? Is it something that's new? Were there any delusions? And in this case, there were. She had some hallucinations and things. And so what we did was we separated the parties. We had the wife was committed and had her medications monitored and regulated. The husband, we were able to get regular care back into the house to care for him and bring his health up where it was more stable, because with the caregivers coming and going, depending on whether or not she'd let him in, medications may not be, weren't being delivered on a regular basis. So overall, we wound up in the long run getting a guardianship on both of them. Her guardianship is very limited, and it has to do that she doesn't have the ability to hire and fire caregivers, that power was taken away from her. And part of that was to protect the husband. She is still able to make many of her decisions. She also could not revoke her financial powers of attorney, which meant that we could keep the daughter paying the bills and making sure the financial needs were met. He wound up getting a guardianship that was much more extensive, and again, it was to prevent Mama from coming in as the next of kin and asserting that she had the right to make decisions for him. Because while we were willing to let her risk some of her decision making, we didn't feel it was fair to jeopardize his decisions because of her poor judgment. And these are the difficult cases, because you do have a long-term marriage. You have a family situation that's clearly been in place for a long time. The history of alcohol and substance abuse, those patterns are in there. And how does the court intervene at this instant in time is what we're looking at. And so, again, it's minimal intervention, but protecting both parties where they need to be protected.
Okay, who's we in that scenario?
The we? Yeah. Me as an attorney in the family is what I'm talking about.
Yeah, so the family was initiating.
The family, yes. And in this case, the family got along. I have one that's going to mediation that's almost identical facts on Monday. And I have siblings on each side, 3 and 3, and those are the really hard ones. In this case, it was a brother and a sister, and they got along well. And they came in, and basically, the sister was a nurse, and she'd been dealing with the care in the home, and she was very good, but she was totally worn out. And the brother's out of town, so what they agreed was that she'd kind of manage it behind the scenes, and he'd be the one who'd have to make the phone call and say, "Mom, too bad, so sad." And, you know, that's the kind of thing that makes it easier for the caregiver on the ground, who's really doing the work, to not have to bear all the emotional. But you can't do that unless the family's getting along. So sometimes you'll make decisions about that. The daughter had also been handling the finances, and so she was able to stay in the financial loop and continue managing them. And you know, I don't think there was any question when the court looked at the records about her abusing them or taking money. Caveat was that the caregiver then made bad decisions and took them to Walmart and let Mom go in the store, and Mom fell and broke her hip. So I think that situation is, again, once unstable, but those are the kinds of things that are going to happen. I think when you're looking at these, I put a list of signs in the little green flyer, and feel free to give that to clients. And particularly, there's a list of things for family members to look at, because one of the things family members, and I'm sure you hear it, "Well, Mom's just a little forgetful, but she's fine otherwise." And what we're really trying to get at are the things that you test for, which are those judgment skills, and whether or not Mom is making good decisions. And so helping them think about it in really practical terms. You know, is Mom still able to make a menu and a grocery list? And helping families recognize those very simple things. There's the classic symptoms that we've put on here, but I think if you can put it into a practical term for the family, that helps them translate what you're thinking medically. And that's where, when they come into our office and we're talking and you ask them, "Well, is Dad balancing the checkbook?" "No, and you know, he used to do that so meticulously. He stood at his dresser and did it every night after work, and he's not doing that anymore." Well, if the family recognizes that those little habits are gone, then it may be easier to understand what's going on. The other thing that we see frequently is that families don't recognize the deficits of the older person. I had the most extreme case was a family member who was held at gunpoint by her mother, who had a long history of schizophrenia, who'd gone undiagnosed. The daughter was a medically trained person. She was there with her brother-in-law, who was an attorney. And dad was in renal failure, and they were trying to get him out of the house to have care. And mom was holding him hostage. They finally convinced mom to let him take dad to the doctor, and we immediately filed for a temporary guardianship on both of them. Mom showed up at the courthouse, and I told the family, this was like 24 hours later, you need to go downstairs and sign the affidavit because we need to get a mental health evaluation on her. And they said, well, mom's always been eccentric. They didn't even see this as a problem. And these were highly educated people. So when you're hearing these stories in your office, a lot of times I think what's happened is that over time it's gotten so gradually and incrementally worse that families don't recognize that they have a problem in their own midst. And it particularly goes with caregivers who don't recognize, you know, well, he's now wandering all night long. He always got up because he was an insomniac, and they don't see the difference between sundowning and not sleeping well. And whether or not they're connected, I don't know, but I do know that, you know, spouses frequently don't sense that there's been even a change because it's something that's always been part of their pattern. I think we've gone through the affidavit. Do any of you have questions about the medical affidavit and the form that we use at the courthouse? This is a standard form, and it is used throughout Texas. It's not a national form, but you're going to see the same form if you're any place in the state of Texas. It's a court-propagated form.
In the page number 3, the second question, the first and the second question, he has a blank slot for some numbers.
Uh-huh.
What do you mean?
What we're asking is, if we allow this, we're looking at least restrictive. And so we have to limit the guardianship to what that person is capable of doing. So what we're looking for there is how much money can they handle and make reasonable decisions with. And that goes to, can they make a decision about a dress? You know, that's kind of that $100 decision. Can they make a decision about a washing machine, which is that $500? And then you think about the, you know, $5,000 is maybe can they contract to get their house painted, and could they weigh and balance that? And then you're thinking about the $10,000 to $20,000 decision. Could they go buy a car and negotiate and come up with a fair deal? And so what you're kind of doing is filling in the number of what kinds of decision level can they make. I know, Dr. Roald, are you going to tell me that you can't test that finally?
Well, I was just thinking about that. I was thinking how, you know, psychometrically difficult it would be to think of the task that way, but I think what you're really asking is the level of complexity of the decision making. So buying a dress involves a whole lot fewer issues than buying, you know, a $20,000 car.
Right.
So it's not really about the money.
Right.
It's about the money and all that that implies.
Exactly.
And the unstated part is the all that that implies.
Correct.
And so the question is just written in a way that it's hard to really know what anybody needs. But,
does that translation make sense? Okay, because I think, you know, and what we see routinely is, I don't know, men just love those cars, you know. And boy, when judgment starts to go, I've set aside more contracts for cars. And it's like, and that's exactly what we're getting at when we're looking at that. Can they make that kind of a complex decision? Because it's, they always go out and they pay the sticker price, and that's your first sign that they haven't made a good deal. They just go out and buy it because they can. So, you know, if you can come up with a complexity decision level, then we can fill in what the estate's valued at and what they can afford to lose. And I had a lady who had a several million dollar estate, and she'd always had a checking account, and she had $1 million in her checking account when we started the guardianship, which was, again, one of those signs. But she wanted to have enough so she could always write a check for whatever she needed. Well, the judge let us leave $10,000 in that account for her because she felt that, you know, she could lose that without risking her ability to care for herself. And ironically, I think the most she ever wrote a check for was about $12 at the beauty parlor. So it was more of a psychological comfort than a real
manic kind of expenditure that we were worried about. And again, when you're looking at that, you may want to look at that. Is there a mental illness that's going to cause him to go out and spend exorbitantly? Or is this someone from the Depression who is never going to give more than 10 crisp $1 bills to their grandkids because that's what they've always given, and that was a lot of money. There are alternatives to guardianship, and I think it's important to review those real quickly as I sum up here. The first thing we're going to look at is whether or not they have medical directives. And if they have medical directives and you find they're unable to make medical decisions, those medical directives can go into place. You have to have two physicians documented in the medical chart. And what I've been seeing pretty consistently from the medical institutions is there's some kind of form that each institution has that they put in the front of the chart, and you document that, you know, physician one has said they're unable to make decisions, and then physician two countersigns with them. So you might want to check out what that process is if you're not sure. Medical directives, though, can be revoked. There is no capacity to make or revoke them. And then on the medical directives, the other factor that's really crucial is that you don't have to have written directives. You can have oral directives. And again, those have to be documented in the chart, have to have two witnesses, and then the physician has to sign off on them. So those oral directives can be made, and you can have them made by the family or as a surrogate decision maker or by the patient themselves if they don't have them and you believe they have the capacity to make them. So it's real important to get those oral medical directives in there. They oftentimes get lost in the chart, so you may want to work with your nurses to make sure you've got it in a place you can find it, and it's when it gets filed away between hospitalizations that it can be found again. Surrogate decision making is really important in Texas. It helps us avoid guardianships. When I first started practicing about 16 years ago, I was appointed routinely to go into hospitals and make medical decisions because people didn't have capacity and we didn't have any surrogate decision making. So, you know, the Friday afternoon call at 4 o'clock was usually the judge calling saying they needed to go down to Baptist Hospital because somebody needed surgery or something. Nowadays, we have surrogate decision making, and so family members can step in. There's a statutory hierarchy. It's the spouse, the adult, the majority of the adult children, the next of kin, and then there's this grayed out, and that's the clergy. So if you have a clergy person, and I know the hospices have had, their clergies are fairly well trained on this. I think some of the hospital chaplains have stepped up to the plate on this. And again, it varies from facility to facility, but we have very little guardianships done just for sheer medical decision making. The one time that we will have them done is when the family is fighting and the doctor's not sure who to listen to and that sort of thing. But typically, we've had very few, and we don't even have any case law really on this. The only cases involve babies, and they're out of Houston, and they're all on extreme measures for life support. I think we're going to start seeing more cases in Texas on this. There's a very strong movement coming on futile care, and there's a statewide group that is routinely filing suits around the state when hospital ethics committees have made decisions and decided that it is futile care, and they're coming in and suing the hospitals. So I think it's an unfortunate movement, but we're going to start seeing more and more of that. On the estate, this is where we get into the more practical and difficult decisions. These typically are not emergency decisions. The judges don't usually think that a nursing home bill is something that's an emergency. And so what they're going to say is that do the guardianship in a routine way. The types of things that we see financially as an emergency are things where we've got the con artist coming in and getting him to give money to the Jamaican lottery or the Canadian lottery. Or the QVC folks have gotten a hold of a credit card number, and we've got boxes and boxes of product in somebody's house, and you know, we're trying to get that stopped. And that's where we'll see the emergency guardianships on financial matters. But the preventative things that we can do on financial matters are the powers of attorney and trust. Powers of attorney, it means that they have appointed someone to act in their stead. So they appoint an agent, and this person literally stands in their shoes and can make financial decisions.
The issue with that is that you've got to have somebody you trust, and a lot of our older adults don't have family members, and so then, or close friends or relatives, or someone who's financially responsible. So we wind up in a guardianship for that reason. If someone is appointed as an agent, they have the duty to account. They have to make decisions that are in the principal, the maker of the power of attorney's best interest. And the other problem we have is that third parties don't have to recognize powers of attorney. So if Mrs. Smith gave her daughter a power of attorney and her daughter goes to the bank doesn't have to accept it. And if the bank rejects it, then we wind up having to go a different route. You know, we may try to schmooze them a little bit. That's usually the first line. And if that doesn't work, then we wind up having to do a guardianship. A stronger method, and one that we're using more and more, even on smaller estates, is to do a trust, because the trust is a contractual relationship that takes place immediately. They retitle the bank accounts so that the bills and things can be paid. So when somebody's sitting in your office and they're sick and the family's saying, I can't pay the bills, these are the sorts of things that we're looking at to see how we can get the CPS and the SAWS bill paid so that mama can stay home maybe a little longer. And the trust is sometimes a good option. If you'll have any other questions about this, yes?
In the same page, uh-huh. And you the power and authority to make decisions related to military service, I guess all folks won't have military obligations.
No, they won't. Again, what we're looking at on that one primarily is mental health or mentally retarded kids that are aging up.
Let's say that all patients do a business that is not convenient for him or for her, and the patient is mentally disabled or discapacitated. And let's say that a week later, something happened that caught the attention of the family, and then they are evaluating and somebody has to take the guardianship. Can you go back and undo the business to protect the patient?
Yeah, the question is, can you undo what somebody's maybe done, like buy the car, and then can you set it aside? And the answer is maybe. I mean, we've even done it on, I had somebody last year who, there was a stray, niece that showed up that had never been close to this lady, and she got her to amend her trust and to deed her house and all sorts of things. And so what we did was we went back and we had the physician's testimony that said that she suffered from dementia, that it was a very slow dementia, and we had the medical records to prove it, and that in this 3-month period there had not been any medical incident, there was no infectious or organic reason, and so we were able to go back and set aside those documents and put her back to where she was, because the documents that had been in place before those, that little, it was about a 2-week period of time, had been in place for 20 years and had been re-upped over and over again. And so, the court's going to look at that pattern of those documents as well as the medical evidence that showed that she was stable, there hadn't been any kind of stroke or, anything that would cause a sudden turn. So yes, you can undo them. And I have on a car deal, the first one I set aside, we filed the guardianship at 1 o'clock, and the car dealer had him sign it at 2 o'clock, and we went out and we said, yeah, but the judge said at 1:48 you couldn't do this. And they were like, well, and then the second time, about 2 weeks later, it was ironic, I had the same car dealer, and he said, I just told the manager to set it aside. So, it's that kind of thing where the first time you may have to work at it a little bit, but the second time, if you're going back to the same vendors, they're not going to be as tough.
What does it take to undo a guardianship?
That's a good question. I've only undone two in my practice. And you have to have medical statements saying that they now have capacity and that they now have their affairs. And in one of them, it was actually a physician who had had a medical incident, and it was one of those, I think half the community in San Antonio had opinions on, because his family had gone out and solicited him. But basically what was determined was that he would give up his medical license, but he did have that he was a very brilliant man, and so that he had capacity to make average decisions that average people would make and to handle his finances. And so he couldn't practice medicine, but he could come out from under the guardianship. And the other one was a lady a couple years ago, and it was a strange situation where she married quickly after a long-term marriage, and her new husband sort of left her without oxygen for a little while, hoping, I think, she'd die, and she didn't. She got to the hospital, and they brought her back. And initially, the family did the guardianship to protect her because they were concerned the spouse was going to get back in there. And then they took her out of state, and they had a great psychologist up in Colorado who worked with her, and she got healthy and mentally healthy, and she came back, and she's now living alone and doing quite well. But again, I think the guardianship was as much protection as it was her, and it was a medical kind of incapacity at the time. But it's pretty difficult. And it's difficult to come out because you don't go into guardianships lightly. You know, guardianships aren't done. Sometimes they'll happen quickly, but they aren't done without thought and circumspect. The person going into the guardianship has an attorney, and that attorney's role is to make sure that we aren't taking away their right to contract and their right to vote and their civil rights and things without a lot of forethought. So coming out of the guardianship is done with just as much circumspect, because we don't want to give somebody back that power. And if they weren't driving because we didn't think they were able to, putting them back out on the road and some of those kinds of things. So it's, you can come out of it, but the coming out is harder because you don't go in without pretty careful examination.
We think one of the strongest determinants of the need for guardianship are executive impairments. Mm-hmm. But we're starting to have some success in treating them. So I've actually seen patients who are institutionalized on the basis of their, quote, dementia, unquote, that now we've reversed the cognitive impairment, it's not there anymore. And yet they're imprisoned at that level of care by what all has gone on that got them there in the first place. See, so the house is sold, their estate is under someone else's control. Right. The nursing home likes Mr. Jones because he's the best patient they got. And I said, yeah, but he's normal.
Right.
You know?
Right.
So no wonder he's the best patient you got. So the whole world is right. against us there. And I think that, you know, to the extent that the treatment of executive impairments becomes more practical, mm-hmm. the world's going to have to rethink how flexibly they need to be able to take people out. Because the presumptions people have about dementia being a permanent, progressive state may be limited to particular disease states and not to the dementia syndrome in
right.
general.
Well, and I think you're right, and I think a lot of times that's why we will keep people in a temporary guardianship. The couple that I used as the example, we actually have them under a temporary guardianship instead of a permanent, because if mama stays sober, she may be able to come back and handle things. You know, and I think there's
right.
that sort of element. But the process to undo a guardianship is that someone has to write a letter to the court. So if you as physicians believe that someone doesn't belong in a guardianship, writing that letter will trigger the court to appoint what's called a guardian ad litem. And this is a person whose job is to look at the ward, the person under guardianship's best interest. And so they'll come in and they'll talk to you as a physician. They'll look at other medical records. They may ask for some independent testing. And then they will go back to court and make a report. And the report may be an application to restore the ward. And so that can be done. But you're right about the estate, because the physician who went under guardianship's wife, who promptly started divorce proceedings, began just dissipating his practice. So, you know, it was kind of one of those things, what do you do when somebody isn't in a permanent state of incapacity? And I think the law is in flux right now about this subject. I think we're now looking at changes that were made 10, 15 years ago that we didn't have a black and white line. We now have a spectrum.
We also have said you have to have attorneys, or that's the recommendation, and I think over half the states now have attorneys who represent the person going under guardianship. It's not just the whim of the child or the husband going and putting him in an institution. I think we saw a lot of cases like this in the 60s with mental health, where people were locked up. There are famous cases out of Florida, the teenage son who was out of control that was locked up and couldn't get out of it, and it was the case that triggered the whole commitment process that now is uniform across the nation, that, you know, you can't just lock somebody up in a mental health institution. And unfortunately, with older adults and with dementia, a couple of years ago I did a paper for the state bar on this subject, because I went out and the lady's daughter said she had dementia. She'd been discharged from a psych ward here locally. She was sitting there working the New York Times crossword puzzle, and she was really mad that she was in a locked psych ward. And it took about 2 weeks, I mean a locked dementia unit, it took me about 2 weeks to get her out of that unit and into a traditional assisted living, and then she went from there home. But it was a kind of incremental to prove that she could live independently and act independently. But again, it was triggered probably by a mental health incident that had been unmedicated and untreated, and once it was treated, she functioned pretty well, and she did quite well for several years. So I think that those, that being locked up is really a big deal, and I think it's going to become more and more of a deal. And you guys are going to be on the cutting edge of it if you're in geriatrics.
Is there any kind of a legal assistance for physician, just in case that they want to understand better the legal terms?
There's an excellent paper that was done by the APA and the American Psychiatric Association. And it's available on the website, and it is on both websites, and it's on capacity. You have to kind of fish for it, but you might look for that. I would encourage you all to consider even going to a legal seminar on guardianships. I don't know if you could get some of your MCLE credits on it. But I think if you're going to be practicing in geriatrics, that it would certainly help you to understand and just to go to one of the basic guardianship seminars. I know in San Antonio we have the docket call that's done about every other year, and it's kind of a basic probate thing. You don't need to sit through it all, but I'd go to maybe the guardianship section. And the state bar does one every year on guardianship and Medicaid issues, and both of those are kind of issues that might help you all. There's a lot of crossover. I know this year I'm doing a panel with a psychologist from here at the VA on capacity standards, and he's going to talk about testing. I'm going to talk about what the actual legal standard and whether or not you can match them up, because I think that's where we start running afoul is when we're trying to. So I think we're knowing that we need to work with physicians more in this area, and hopefully you all will start working with us more, because I think it is a hand in glove, and as new things are developed and, you know, dementia is treated or mental illness is treated, and as our medications get better, we're going to have to see a lot more in and out and crossover.
Yeah, I have a question.
Sure.
Because it seems like it's different depending on the state, especially mm-hmm. with involuntary commitment. And do you think that's something that will change too, depending on, like, because it does speak to their right, you know. Because I know in California, it's only if you're a harm to someone else. They will not involuntarily commit just because you're a harm to yourself.
The Supreme Court standard is actually a harm to self or others and in a diminishing capacity. And probably it's ripe for a lawsuit, but the pendulum swung, you know, from way over here where you could just basically go lock up your spouse and it was always the wife, to way over here where you can, you know, have a lot of freedom. And I think the other issue that happened sort of simultaneously with that swing was the political swing, where we wanted people out of institutions and into the community, and we don't have institutions, and so you have that double whammy. I know California had that case. It was about the psychiatrist and whether or not he had the duty to disclose the harm that one of his patients was threatening to murder. It was at UC Berkeley. And it was this really convoluted case, and it went back and forth, and it was, you know, I don't know what the final resolution, because it was actually being litigated while I was in law school, but it had gone back and forth several times as to which way the courts came down on it.
Yeah. Okay, because I just, in California, it was so hard. If it was just a situation where they were just killing themselves. You know, like, oh, well, you know, as long as they're not going to kill anyone else, you know, and here it seems like it's